Tonight, government's $42 million road rehab project gets the thumbs up from the Chamber of Commerce and the National Council on Public Transport. A Lucrery bus driver threatens legal action over attempts to block him from plying the route. A recent snakebite victim calls for changes to prevent more injuries and even deaths. And the important role of statistics in achieving the Sustainable Development Goals, the focus of this year's observance of World Statistics Day. Good evening. Welcome to the Friday edition of the DBS News World with me, Kendall Burton. The Ministry of Infrastructure has engaged the St. Lucia Chamber of Commerce, Industry and Agriculture in discussions on a $42 million US road rehabilitation project. The consultation took place on Wednesday and follows a similar meeting with the National Council on Public Transportation. The meetings are the ministry's way of promoting greater public accountability and transparency. Don Nicholas reports on the meeting with the chamber.
The U.S. $42 million road rehabilitation project is being funded through a loan from the government of Taiwan and will rehabilitate 81 kilometers of community and national roads. A company out of Taiwan will oversee the construction and will subcontract to local contractors. The Ministry of Infrastructure engaged the St. Lucia Chamber of Commerce, Industry and Agriculture in discussion on the project. The ministry is looking to modernize its way of doing business, which will involve collecting data on traffic flow and volume in an effort to alleviate traffic congestion. Directional signage is another concern.
As we move forward, we also are considering very seriously the issue of signage, directional signage, to indicate to you which direction the particular route takes you.
The St. Lucia Chamber of Commerce is confident that the project will work in its best interest. The chamber applauded the ministry for the early consultation.
The consultation, like I said earlier, is a very good one. It's good that you're engaging the St. Lucia Chamber of Commerce very early. I know the contractors have been sought and so, and some of the roads have started, but it is good that the chamber members are engaged at that stage so that we could air our views and our concerns and support the project.
The Ministry of Infrastructure is moving to minimize the inconvenience to the motoring public and the business community. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
The National Council on Public Transportation, the NCOPT, meanwhile, has described a recent meeting with the Department of Infrastructure as fruitful. The two entities met on Tuesday, October 15th, to discuss government's $42 million US road improvement and maintenance program. The project spans approximately 101 kilometers of roads to be completely reconstructed around the island. For years, minibus drivers and owners have been complaining about bad roads and their impact on vehicles and their earnings. Sheffield Gaylard reports on that meeting.
Tuesday's meeting was deemed important given the role drivers play in national development. The president of the National Council on Public Transportation, NCOPT, Mr. Godfrey Ferdinand, says recommendations were made by the minibus sector, which were welcomed by the Ministry of Infrastructure.
We gave them some suggestions in terms of the roads that we think that should receive priority when it comes to our operators and those that have been longstanding within the sector. So we gave them the priority roads. We also gave them suggestions to what we think could happen in using certain roads as maybe extended routes, or also to alleviate the traffic on the highway, persons using the back roads. So we give them suggestions to some of the back roads that really need assistance right now.
Other recommendations included the installation of laybys, additional bus stops along the East Coast, and improved road signage island-wide.
There are roads that were not on the schedule for them to deal with presently. And we suggested roads like, I think the Aso Canal Road going into Viesikui. That's one of the roads we suggested. From the council's perspective, we requested that the roads into the Oramo and the Moshi roads moving into Plateau be looked at so that persons could use these roads instead of using the highway. And also we made recommendations to the effect of having some of the roads having what you call V-drains and what you call dog bone slabs instead of these open drains. So a place like Mondido would be one of the areas.
The meeting was held at the Department of Infrastructure with minibus operators in the north of the island. However, a similar consultation will be hosted with NCOPT members and non-affiliates in the south. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
In other news, Tourism Minister Dominic Fede says the closure of the Caribbean Tourism Organization, or CTO, offices in New York and the United Kingdom is for the best. Fede, who is also the chairman of the Barbados-based organization, explains that by closing its two offices, the CTO hopes to undertake a restructuring exercise, which is expected to significantly reduce its operational expenditure. This, he says, will give the CTO freedom to undertake its key functions of regional marketing, research and data collection, as well as product development. Sheffield Gillard tells us more.
The Caribbean Tourism Organization is the Caribbean's regional development agency and is made up of 27 countries, including St. Lucia, and dozens of private sector members.
Absolutely.
Chairman
not.
Of the CTO Dominic Fede says the time has come to restructure the organization, which was established in 1984. The CTO, he says, was paying approximately 35 employees across three offices around the world and had no money to do any programs.
We undertook this restructuring exercise, which would make us a lot more leaner, streamlining our financial and human resources to make sure that the organization is a lot leaner and it can be more effective in executing its duties. So now we're in a better position to do research projects and also to market the Caribbean. This is essentially what the whole restructuring exercise is all about. The impact there would mean the closure of the New York offices and the office in London as well. That allows us greater flexibility and it gives us a lot more capacity financially.
But will St. Lucia's visitor arrivals drop, considering the UK and US are the island's main markets?
Absolutely not. 1984 was a very long time since tourism has come a long way since then. You have to remember, Sheffield, that in those days our economies were agricultural-based economies. And, you know, a lot of our jurisdictions had maybe a desk in the tourism ministry. Now, all of our members have got full-fledged tourism ministries. They've got full-fledged marketing agencies called tourist boards or tourism authorities. And really, this means that the role of the CTO in playing an on-the-ground marketing initiative has sort of changed a whole lot. And CTO has got to reposition to come up with the times. So this is what essentially has happened.
Just this week, the St. Lucia Tourism Authority announced record-breaking visitor arrivals in the month of August, with the US and UK market together recording 25% of the figures. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
A Le Clery minibus operator is threatening to take the Le Clery Minibus Association to court on the grounds that he's being denied the right to continue operating on that route. The association, in its defense, says the operator is yet to satisfy all the requirements to ply the route and has a history of breaking the rules. But this is not the first time that drivers from that association have had to battle things out in court. Don Nicholas has details.
David Black says he started plying the Le Clery route 35 years ago when his father started the business. According to him, since then he has been victimized by the Le Clery Minibus Association. Because of that, he says he transferred his business to the Castries-Groseilliers route, but recently he decided to return to the Le Clery route, but he's being blocked by his colleagues who are accusing him of breaking the rules in the past. He admits that 9 years ago he failed to obey orders by picking up passengers at points other than the designated bus stop. He says he has been unable to convince the association that he would quit the practice. Black has sought legal advice on the matter.
The Lakleri Minibus Association seemed to have a problem with me. I've taken years of victimization, harassment, and I don't know where it comes from. Lawfully, I can't be on the road. I was told so by my lawyer.
President of the association, Aaron King, says there are procedures that must be followed before Mr. Black can be accepted back into the fold. Until then, he cannot be allowed to function as a minibus operator. The president says Mr. Black has met some of the requirements, but not all. Mr. King has denied the accusations of victimization and says a meeting with the National Council on Public Transportation was held Thursday night to discuss the matter.
Within a day or so, we got a letter from a lawyer. So right now, we take a different turn because we just cannot deal with a legal matter. We have to get the higher authorities. And that's where we are now. And the higher authorities, we met with the National Council concerning that.
The matter has been referred to the Transport Ministry, and the association is awaiting the outcome. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Josiah Jono's Kastang is calling for the erection of warning signs along the popular hiking spots after he was bitten by a Fidelas snake last month. With the increase in temperature, the venomous snakes have not been shy of late, and several sightings have been reported along the West Coast especially.
I want to advocate for putting signs. You understand me? We have tourists who frequent these waterfalls and areas upon their own advocate. They do their own thing, okay? And if you put signs, especially like Ansari waterfalls or wherever that we know they are, these foodless vipers are, put up signs and let the people know to be aware, and put some tips. Walk with your shoes, make sure you have your sticks, this and that, and just allow people to know that these areas have those feelings, and just leave it open like the Wild West.
Mr. Kastang was bitten on September 12th while visiting a waterfall in Anse-Lerey. He has since had three surgeries on his right leg.
That is the worst experience someone can go through. I'd rather get shot with a gun, I'd rather fall on a bike and break my leg than to go through a foodless bite. I don't care what people say, that serpent is one of the most deadliest, and it's lethal. It will kill you. There are no two ways about it. The pain I felt, what I went through, I alone don't know what I go through. You have to walk in my shoes to understand what I went through. That serpent, honestly, man and the serpent will never, never walk the same path.
Kastang's leg remains bandaged, and it is still unclear when he will be able to get back on his feet. Time now to join Alex Buske for Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Friday Funnies on Street Vibes. A ship sank with 20 crew members. They all drowned. But when the authorities counted the bodies, they counted 24 heads. How come?
24 heads.
Yeah, like because 20 of them drowned.
Because the four was the four head men in the ship.
20 fellas drown, right? And then the ship sink. And when the ship surface, they get 24 heads. It's hard, eh? It's very hard. But at the same time, it's exciting. To me, the heads drown, but not the body. I don't know.
When the body float, they count 24. Yeah. How comes? Well, that's a hospital with doctors, so they count how many that make success, and they're not counting how many died in their hands, and that's it.
They had 20 when they checked this in 24.
Yeah. 24.
I even know. That had it.
A ship sank with 20 crew members. They all drowned. When the authorities counted the bodies, they counted 24 heads. How come? It was correct. The count was correct. They counted 24 heads. You've just been watching Friday Funnies on Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
You're watching St. Lucia's Television and a News Leader, and you can listen to us on Rhythm FM 95.5 and the Wave 94.5 and 93.7 FM. We're also on the web and streaming live on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Coming up, the important role of statistics in achieving the Sustainable Development Goals, the focus of this year's observance of World Statistics Day, and empowering girls to break the cycle of physical and sexual abuse. Welcome back. The Department of Statistics is getting ready to undertake a census that will assess living conditions in local households and which will in turn inform government's social and economic development policies. The announcement comes just days ahead of World Statistics Day, observed on October 20th. Don Nicholas tells us more.
World Statistics Day, observed on October 20th, serves to highlight the importance of data collection as it relates to formulating government policy and decision-making. The local Department of Statistics is involved in ongoing data collection activities. The department is preparing for a census scheduled to begin in May 2020, which will span 4 months. The census will take into account the gender, age, and occupation of householders, among other details, with a view to devising socio-economic policies.
What this allows the department to do, any statistical department to do, is that it allows the department to take account of not just the population, but also the housing. And this would allow the department to plan and to execute future statistical initiatives.
The department has just concluded a disability assessment and is in the process of compiling a report in order to chart the way forward. Data collection is also critical in achieving the Sustainable Development Goals agenda. It helps to monitor progress levels in achieving the goals.
The SDGs is data-driven. It's rarely a situation where, with the advent of the SDGs, that has led to what has been termed the data revolution. And as a result of that, the importance of statistics and data, the importance that has been placed on statistics and data was even more highlighted.
The Sustainable Development Goals agenda comprises 17 goals, which include no poverty, zero hunger, decent work, and good health, all of which the United Nations hopes can be achieved by the year 2030. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The Deputy Director and Clinical Counselor at the Upton Gardens Girls Centre says the cycle of violence against girls and women can only be broken by empowering young women. She made the comments during International Day of the Girl Child Observances, and her call is for more to be done to help young girls realise their full potential by ensuring they grow up under the right conditions and with adequate support and encouragement to have their voices heard. Alex Bousquet explains.
The Deputy Director and Clinical Counselor says most young women who are sexually harassed or molested will live with the memory of that experience without sharing it because of the fear of the reaction they will get.
That is a big issue across for girls. And girls are in situations where they would come out and share certain things that are going on with them and they are not adhered to. They are not believed. Their story is being questioned. Their circumstances are being watered down. A lot of the responses you get is, what did you do to create this? A lot of responses you got is, you must have done something. And so we do not, again with the word empowerment, we do not have the girls to really be able to feel comfortable to tell their story how it is. Sometimes they don't even understand what is going on with them. Another thing that's happening is that we have a lot of girls who are very matured, right? With their thinking and the way they see things. But developmentally, we also have to understand what's happening with the brain. So there is still a child in there that still needs to be molded. So you have persons who are not able to bridge that gap. And so they see a girl who is acting like a big woman and they are not able to reach out in an empathetic, in a nurturing way to give that girl the love and the molding and the grooming that she needs.
Particularly in the Caribbean region, Mrs. Cools Vitalis says, when young girls express that level of maturity and the call comes to continue nurturing them, most adults take a step back and the girls are left on their own.
Another thing for girls looking at the celebration of them is for a cemented relationship with their parents, their family members, you have a lot of issues where girls are saying the mother chooses the boyfriend over them, you know, and these perpetuate a lot of negativity, affects the self-esteem. So with younger girls, I'm looking at children, between the ages of 5 and up. You have to be able to develop that relationship of openness, being able to not have topics taboo anymore. I'm sticking on sexual matters because that is a great challenge that we are facing with children. A lot of sexualized behaviors that they are being confronted with, but we can combat it by very early o'clock talking about these discussions, talking about the bodies, talking about the proper names for our bodies, the word sex not being taboo in the home, the word penis not being taboo in the home.
Addressing such matters of sexuality as a normal everyday discussion, Mrs. Cools Vitalis says, will encourage the girls to express themselves and realize their full potential. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
The Department of Fisheries will be hosting a Fishers Clinic on October 31st. This will be the second such clinic. The Fishers Clinic encourages health and wellness screening by fisherfolk and also addresses topics like safety at sea.
The Fishers Clinic is primarily for fishers within nearby communities, so it will be in Denry, but we are opening this up to all the nearby communities. Come out on the day, you have the fisheries department, a lot of our stakeholders, the Met Services, NEMO, and a number of other partners who will be on hand to provide insurance information, banking information, tips on how you could repair your engines, how to maintain your engines, so your engine providers, Mercury, Yamaha.
Representatives from Mercury and Yamaha will be on hand to educate fishers on engine maintenance and repair techniques, especially when they encounter difficulty while at sea.
The department is keen on safety, fisher safety, and we are doing these clinics around St. Lucia to ensure that our fishers, their health, their wellness, and all of that is incorporated. So we again call out all the Denry fishers, Miku, Pwale, all nearby communities in the south on the 31st, Thursday of October, come out in large numbers. The clinic runs from 1 p.m. until 6 p.m. We want to cater to persons coming out from sea, and so the clinic starts at 1 p.m. until 6 p.m. on a Thursday, the 31st of October. Come out and learn some more about fisheries. It's a day set out for fishers.
The Fishers Clinic will take place in Denry. The Juniors Under Mentorship Program, or JUMP, brought the curtains down on its Read With Me program. The program was 3 months long and was held in communities across the island. JUMP is a mentorship program registered with the Ministry of Youth and Sports since 2015. The sole purpose of JUMP is to mentor the youth of St. Lucia, focusing on 4 key areas: academics, music, sports, and the arts. Alex Bousquet has more.
Founder of the JUMP organization, Bernice Lewis, says the children are selected by first engaging with the community schools and finding out who is interested in the areas that JUMP offers mentoring in.
So we had small groups of children, about 10 or 12 children. We got them together on a Saturday, read them local books or books from local authors. So Jacinta Lee-Anius's book, Don French. We have so many good authors who have produced St. Lucian work, and it's actually, you know, pretty much ties into our history, our culture, so that way they could relate a little more and enjoy the reading and enjoy just fraternizing with on a Saturday morning.
The island's sole power company, Lucilec, supported JUMP's Read With Me mentorship program to ensure that the students had the opportunity to not just read for pleasure, but also to encourage an independent reading culture at the schools and the wider society.
We understand that an effective literacy program would improve phonics awareness, vocabulary, fluency, comprehension, and writing, and improve the overall academic performance of the students, and also boost their confidence in the classroom. Lucilec is happy to have assisted JUMP in taking the program to several schools, and we look forward to deepening the collaboration to as a guiding light for students to improve their overall academic performance.
Tell me, why were you interested in this project?
Because it helps me read and it also encouraged me to write more stories. To read more books.
Tell me some of the books you've read.
I've read The Good Little Book, My Little Book of Tales, Cinderella and Snow White.
So how do you think reading some of these books have helped you in your school, in your composition?
It have helped me with my spelling and my writing.
If anyone would like to get involved or volunteer, you can call 721-2038 or email jump758@gmail.com. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
When the DBS News World continues, the winners of this year's Schools Calypso competition receive their prizes. The Events Company of St. Lucia held a prize-giving ceremony for winners of the school's Calypso competition this week. That competition was held at the National Cultural Center on the 7th of June. The event saw 20 schools taking part, 11 primary schools and 9 secondary schools.
For the first time, what we had to do was have one day for the primary schools and another day for the secondary schools. And that was specifically because of the level of interest. The National Cultural Center can no longer accommodate both groups on the same day. And I have to say it was a well-advised decision that we made in order for us to accommodate everybody. On both days, we had the National Cultural Center filled to capacity, not in terms of just the participants, but we had schools who were not even participating who made the time to come out and to support those participating schools.
The prizes for the winners included Amazon tablets, headphones and other electronic gadgets.
Lucilec recognizes the importance of the performing arts in education is very significant, and therefore we are happy to have supported the National Schools Calypso competition to give children the opportunity to perform or help out even behind the scenes. Performing arts not only engages with the creative side of the brain, but it also provides an ideal balance for students to develop their patterns of study. And Lucilec is mindful of the impact that when we support education and the growth and development of our children, that we are indeed creating a wonderful pool of resources for future workers.
Corinth Secondary School placed first, the Cashies Comprehensive Secondary School second, and the Bocage Secondary School third. In the primary schools category, Anglican Primary came in first, Chiroche RC Primary second, and Grand Riviere Primary third. Glittering Sands Beach Facility, St. Lucia's newest tourist attraction, has been commissioned in the town of Anstley. The newly opened beach facility features a beach restaurant, a spa, outdoor showers, a souvenir shop, water sports, among other amenities.
For a very long time in the history of tourism, communities like Anstley have been forgotten and have been neglected and ostracized. And so today, as the parliamentary rep for the area, I am most proud. In a way, this is history being created. The combined economic impact, there are about 20-odd jobs that are being provided in various areas. And so I am moved with emotion, and it's all part of what my government believes in sustainable development, creating jobs for people, and ensuring that, you know, young people, old people, have opportunities everywhere they go.
The initiative is undertaken by the government of St. Lucia in collaboration with private partners.
I've been exploring avenues to look for ventures outside of Trinidad, and St. Lucia is a gold mine. I want to thank the Minister of Tourism and the government of St. Lucia for giving us the opportunity to develop this establishment. It's not for us, it is for the people of Anstley and the surrounding areas. So Anstley is going to be a tourism magnet for St. Lucia. This is just the beginning. we have employed a lot of young people from the area. We have a lot of, as the minister say, enterprise people we are bringing in. We can do things by ourselves, but we choose to go the other way. We want to bring people who have establishment into this place to make a revenue. The cruise ships, to my view, are like a floating central bank. You have to tap every penny from those ships, and this is one such avenue.
And that facility was officially opened on Thursday. The St. Lucia Teachers Credit Cooperative Limited is encouraging its members to help grow the organization as it seeks to adapt to the global financial landscape. This was the message when the organization held a lecture under the theme Local Service, Global Reach. And that lecture was among the activities to mark International Credit Union Day on Thursday. Here's Don Nicholas with more.
The lecture held by the St. Lucia Teachers Credit Cooperative Limited sought to enlighten members on the credit union movement and what the pioneers and stalwarts did to keep the organization up and running. A Distinguished Service Award ceremony was held. It's the first of its kind. 10 founding members were awarded for contributing to the growth of the cooperative. This forms part of activities to mark International Credit Union Day, commemorated on the third Thursday of October. The ultimate goal is to raise awareness about the work credit unions are doing around the world and give members the opportunity to get more engaged.
We awarded the St. Lucia Teachers Union, which partners with us every single year on many different activities. And because they believe in us and because we share joint membership where they also promote the credit union to their members, we found it fitting that we also recognize the St. Lucia Teachers Union this evening.
The St. Lucia Teachers Cooperative Credit Union Limited is a cooperative financial organization established on June 23, 1984 and registered number 45 on August 28, 1986 to assist its members in improving their social and economic well-being. This year's activities sought to keep members in step with technological and financial changes on the global landscape.
We've also seen that St. Lucia has a high literacy rate and there's also a high mobile phone density. What that simply says to us is that the population is becoming more mobile and more connected.
On Saturday, June 30th, 2018, the Teachers Credit Cooperative hosted a digital blitz day for its members and the public to introduce its new mobile banking app. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Stay tuned to DBS News World. We'll continue in a moment.
Good evening. Welcome to the DBS Sports. We kick off with news on football. The finals of the Corporate Warfare Knockout Futsal Competition have been decided following the conclusion of the semi-final matches on Saturday, 12 October at the Bosaju Indoor Practice Facility. Sandals Grand edged out KFC 5-4, with the goals coming from a hat-trick by Gabriel Bissett, Tev Lawrence and Louis George. For KFC, Bobby Constantine scored a brace, with the other goals from Nitas Pascal and Chauvin George. Infrastructure, they had a comfortable 6-2 win over Digicel. Nicholas Lawrence got a hat-trick and Troy George a brace. The grand finals will now be played between Infrastructure and Sandals Grand this evening from 8:30 at the Bosaju Indoor Practice Facility, with the winner pocketing the top prize of $1,000. Prior to the finals, there will be two exhibition celebrity matches. VSV comes up against Compris Sweat, while Team Lama representing Cerebral Palsy comes up against Team Sami representing St. Lucia Crisis Center. So far, a total of 199 goals have been scored, with Infrastructure leading with 26, followed by Digicel with 23 and KFC with 18. The leading goal scorers are Tev Lawrence of Sandals Grand with 8, followed by Zachary Edmond and Lynch Isidore of the St. Lucia Teachers Union, and Bobby Constantine of KFC with 7 goals each. Nictus Pascal, also of KFC, and Aramis Lord of Infrastructure finished with 6 goals each. There have been 15 hat tricks, 2 each by Tev Lawrence of Sandals Grand and Nictus Pascal of KFC. 4 matches will be played in the National Lotteries Authority sponsored Ireland Cup at the Marshall Grounds. On Saturday 19th, Denry plays Central at 6 p.m., with Marshall coming up against Canaries at 8 p.m. This will be followed by another doubleheader on Sunday, 20th October. Mabeo Valley, they play Rosa Valley, and that game kicks off at 6 p.m., followed by an encounter between Grosley and Viva South. That game kicks off at 8 p.m. Where in the women's competition, two games will be played on Saturday 19th at the Philip Massey grounds in VA4. From 2 p.m., VA4 North, they play the National Under 15 team, and at 4 p.m., Ansari comes up against VA4 South. Meanwhile, the finals of the St. Lucia Football Association Zonal Under 17 football competition, well, that takes place at the Larry Seuss playing field in the Mabeo Valley on Saturday 18th October. The third place playoff between Pioneers FC of Castries and RYO of the Mabeo Valley will kick off at 10 a.m., while the grand finals between 1987 All-Stars of Anslery and Victory Eagles of VA4 will be played at 11:30 a.m. The Ministry of Sport secondary school sporting competitions continue across the island in the various disciplines. We have some results in under 19 basketball. Well, Sir Arthur Lewis Community College, well, they overpowered Patricia James Secondary 85-11. In under 19 netball, Sufre Comprehensive defeated St. Joseph's Convent 37-25. For Sufre, goal attack Tansi Pascal netted 25 from 36 attempts, and goal shoot Chichelle Didier 12 from 22 attempts. For St. Joseph's Convent, goal attack Trenis St. Croix netted 13 from 21 attempts, and goal shoot Gracie Alcide 12 from 17 attempts. In another game played, Miku Secondary defeated Leon Hess Comprehensive 45-30. For Miku Secondary, goal shoot Semaj Marguerite netted 44 from 52 attempts, and goal attack Brianna Daniel, she scored 1 from 4 attempts. For Leo Hess Comprehensive, goal attack Raquel Jones scored 23 from 33 attempts, and goal shoot Shanice De Rivière 7 from 9 attempts. In the third game played, Castries Comprehensive defeated Shrozel Secondary 36-8. For the Castries Comprehensive, goal shoot Renard Jean shot 26 from 38 attempts, and goal attack Erin George 10 from 14 attempts. For Shrozel Secondary, goal attack Villeni Gustav netted 4 from 5 attempts, and goal shoot Nella Nelson 4 from 15 attempts. Meanwhile, Beanfield Comprehensive recorded their second win of the football tournament, defeating Grand Rivière Secondary 5-1 in the under 15 competition. Well, we change to cricket. Matches in the Castries Cricket Association Paul Remis T25 competition continues this coming weekend with weather permitting. Two matches are scheduled for Saturday 19th October at the Minda Phillip Park. At 9:30 a.m, New Park plays the under 19 team, while at 2:30 p.m, Unique plays United Raiders Cricket Club. One game is scheduled for Sunday 20th October with Shamrock playing Lancers at 10 a.m. To date, New Park remains the only unbeaten team in the competition with 4 wins from 5 matches, totaling 18 points. Police has also gathered 18 points from 6 matches. While Lancers and United Raiders are on 10 points, Shamrock and the under-19s are 8 points, and Unique, well, they're yet to register a point. Stay tuned, more sports after the break. Thank you for staying tuned. We stay with cricket. The St. Lucia National Cricket Association will be holding its final Board of Management meeting before their biennial general meeting tomorrow, Saturday 18th. The meeting, which will be held at the St. Lucia National Cricket Association office at the Minda Phillip Park in Marsha, is expected to confirm the date for the much-anticipated biennial general meeting, constitutionally due in November. Among the agenda items to be discussed will be local cricket, the financial update by the Treasurer, Cricket West Indies and Windward Islands Cricket Board of Control matters. Well, still in cricket, a Cricket West Indies-sponsored Level 2 coaching course is scheduled to be held from October 22nd to 25th in Grenada and will involve 17 participants. Among those already confirmed for attendance at the course is former West Indies and Windward Islands wicketkeeper Junior Murray, as well as former Windward Islands middle-order batsman John Eugene. Eugene has also been St. Lucia's National 15 coach for the last couple of years. The facilitator will be Windward Islands Territorial Development Officer Ian Allen, along with 5 other facilitators, one of whom will be an assessor from England. Development Officer for Grenada Raphael Crony points out that this is part of the overall development plan, all geared towards improving the human resource base in the four Windward Islands and the ultimate improvement in the cricketing skills of the players at all levels. Sessions will be held daily from 8:30 a.m. to 6 p.m., but on the first day, the sessions will be from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. Well, fast bowling legend Sir Andy Roberts has questioned the appointment of Miles Bascom to the West Indies men's selection panel and believes the former Windward Island batsman should have withdrawn himself from consideration after having been a member of the recent Cricket West Indies task force, which led an overhaul of regional selection policy. Further, the outspoken former Windies coach contended Bascom did not possess enough first-class experience to sufficiently qualify him for the role he now occupied beside former Test off-spinner Roger Harper and newly appointed head coach Phil Simmons. Bascom's appointment came as a surprise, especially considering his tepid playing career, which yielded 24 first-class matches at an average of 21 and a single 2020 international for West Indies against England 8 years ago. Sir Andy, however, supported Harper's appointment as chief selector, pointing out that the former West Indies head coach ticked all the boxes. Shallow, who chaired the interview panel during the recruitment process for selectors, defended Bascom's appointment, however, arguing that the process had been a robust one that had seen the former player pass every test put before him. Yesterday, however, during debate in the lower chamber of the Barbados Parliament, Prime Minister Mia Mottley, a keen cricket enthusiast, added her voice to the many who have been taken aback by some of the decisions of the newly reconfigured board. Mottley expressed deep concerns about the sweeping changes that Skerritt and Shallow had overseen since taking over at the helm of the regional governing body for cricket. And finally tonight, where long jump world record holder Mike Powell believes that Jamaica's World Championships gold medalist Tajay Gale has all the tools required to erase his 28-year-old world record. Gale shocked the world when he upset Cuban Juan Miguel Echevarria to win gold in the men's long jump final at the Doha 2019 World Championships with a massive 8.69-meter personal best. American Jeff Henderson, 8.39 meters, took a silver medal with the Cuban finishing third with a best of 8.34 meters. The Jamaicans winning a distance was the best mark registered since Dwight Phillips' 8.74 meters in 2009 and makes him the 10th best jumper in history. The 55-year-old American, who was in the stands at the Califia International Stadium to witness Gale's performance on September 28th, was left impressed with both his range and his demonstration of mental fortitude to deliver his best performance on the biggest stage. Stay tuned. The weather is up next. Now to our thought to take you through the night. I asked God, why are you taking me through troubled waters? He replied, because your enemies can't swim. The DBS News continues. Please stay tuned.
On the lighter side tonight, a surprised customer at an Australian restaurant recorded video of a pelican casually wandering into the eatery and patiently getting in line. Jack Simpson captured video at the Cargo's Wharf restaurant in Kiama, New South Wales, when a pelican walked in through the door and joined the crowd in line. The pelican got out of line after a few moments and wandered around the shop with a crowd of onlookers following. The bird was eventually escorted out of the eatery without incident. And that's your lighter side and our news. Before we go, one more look at our top stories. Government's $42 million road rehab project gets the thumbs up from the Chamber of Commerce and the National Council on Public Transport. A Lucerne bus driver threatens legal action over attempts to block him from plying the route. A recent snakebite victim calls for changes to prevent more injuries and even deaths. And the important role of statistics in achieving the Sustainable Development Goals, the focus of this year's observance of World Statistics Day. And that's the DBS News World for today, Friday. I'm Kendall Burton. Thanks for watching. Good evening.